Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of Plenty with Sulo. Our sponsors, Hair and Makeup, Headmasters, our venue partner Hatch, and our camera crew Camera Hub. Be tuned to Daily Mirror Online. Today, our visitor is Aarthi Arunachalam, Employment Lead Women in Work IFC. Hi, Aarthi.
Hi.
This is a very informal discussion. Aarthi, if I ask you to introduce yourself, how would you like to introduce yourself?
All right, so I was born and schooled in Sri Lanka, Colombo. But spent most of my adult phase in multiple countries.
Okay.
That is where I also did my bachelor's, master's in India, and also worked in Indonesia, Malaysia, and also India, Sri Lanka, of course. So growing up, I've had two schools of thoughts of leadership, if I may put it like that. My mom, who always made me feel like you can achieve anything you want, dream big, believe in yourself.
Okay.
My dad, on the other hand, quite a traditional man, but always pushed me to go beyond my boundaries. And at the end, this is the product that you really see. So my parents didn't have the opportunity to voice their opinion or even share or even be educated in that manner. So they made sure that I was educated and also made sure that I get to follow my own dreams.
So you're the only child?
I have two younger sisters as well. So they made sure that the three of us do get a very strong education founding, and all three of us are in our own careers and following whatever that we're doing.
So three girls, well educated. So it's not the parents' dream was to make you all independent, if I may put it that way.
Yes, in a way, yes.
Okay.
And also, I started my career as a management trainee and grew really fast in my career as well.
Yeah, because you're still young.
not really. So I started my journey as a management trainee with TNT Express, and I grew quite fast in my career journey. My previous role was where I was a global HR business partner with a sustainable brand named Purit with Unilever, where I actually managed a team of 500 employees across 12 countries. And my current role is where I'm the employment lead as part of the Women in Work program, where I work very closely with the private sector to help companies bridge gender gaps. So what I mean by this is companies are able to create respectful and equal workplaces, better job opportunities, and the businesses does better too. So,
yeah, I'll just ask a question, because from a management training for the HR, then to a gender, right? What was the change? Why you? It, was it an opportunity or you were looking for a change?
So I would say that for me, what matters is if there's an idea that is in front of you, I make sure that I bring it to life, right? So the transition for me from HR to gender wasn't that hard, because I mean, in HR, I did do a lot on talent, leadership development, management, employer brand, diversity, etc. So the transition was quite easy to move into gender. And very interestingly, I must share the story of how I got into gender. So this was like when I was to get married to my husband, and he actually forwarded this particular email and said that, Aarthi, this is like the perfect role for you to apply for. And I looked at it, it was operations officer, women in work. I went through the description, I didn't understand. But as I scrolled through the email, guess who that email was from? Slide guess.
I'm silver on the reward.
You.
Okay.
So it was literally a forward where it had come from you. I mean, I didn't know you back then. And so my husband and I had this very deep debate of should I apply for it and not apply for it. And then finally, this was on the day of our wedding. And this was the final timeline. Midnight was the deadline. And literally before getting ready for my wedding, I remember sitting and applying for this IFC job.
So and this is your wedding present, and God, I was part of it. Dude.
I don't know. In a way you can call it, but it was crazy. Like after several very stringent interview process, several months, I got the job, and I still wasn't sure if this is what I really wanted to do.
Okay.
And that was the time where I actually had coffee with my previous manager, Carmen Newcomer, and that coffee changed everything. Like, I'm so glad that I had that coffee because I was so clear this is the role that I really wanted to do. And that's how I got into the space of gender.
Great. So I'll just shift to your marriage also, right? As you said, you got your husband ensured that you apply for it. Now, a lot of you're coming from a background where you have a traditional father, but your mother was so motivated to you. But your ethnic is your Tamil and Hindu. Am I correct?
Yeah.
Coming from a family like that, right? And then being educated, then your husband is so supportive, and you ensured you marry on your own time, and you still travel, and you are, I think, now almost 3 to 4 years, right? Mm-hmm. You have been married.
Yeah.
So how being it being supported and all that?
The average age to get married is around 24, 25.
Yeah.
And obviously with all my travels and my career that I was progressing, I was like considered as one of the black sheeps within the community. And
giving a wrong example for younger.
Probably, yeah. Yeah. And at the age of 28, I was literally out of the proposal market. And this caused a lot of stress for my parents. A lot of stress, and that obviously did come on to me as well. But I was very particular. It was not at what age I would get married, but who I would get married to. And that was more important, and I'm so grateful that I actually found my husband, because as a couple together, we really work towards like having goals and aspirations that would support each other, and we can like progress together. So that was something that was really important for me. But in the whole bargain, I would say my parents did go through a lot, because probably for me, I don't have to meet too much within the community, but for them to really...
You don't need to be answered to your relations.
Exactly. But for them, it was different.
Yeah.
And I think with my experience, they really understood, and that it was not the age that mattered. It's finding the right person, which has really eased things out. Actually, my sisters have it easy, probably because of my experience, if you were to put it. But it also makes it quite interesting, because as a woman, like, you should have the right to decide whether you want to get married, not married,
whom you
what
should
age,
get married,
exactly.
Yes.
And also, like, you want to have children, don't want to have children, adopt, or anything like that. But we still live in a society where those questions are asked. So I really hope that parents and spouses do support women, and just let them, I mean, they have the right to choose, so just let them have to choose. And also, Sulochana, like, what's very interesting is, we would never ask this question to a man.
Yes.
Would we? But I do hope we come to a day where we ask the same set of questions for both men and women.
That's what I'm coming, because you know what? Most of the men, when I ask them, they say we want our wife to be educated, but they do not want to marry an educated woman, because they think then it's going to be very difficult to live with. That's why most men prefer to marry a woman who stays at home. So as you said, we don't ask that question, but then again, some educated women find it's difficult to marry that person who will support you. So that unmarried women are much younger generation are mainly unmarried due to this. So it's vice versa, like we don't ask that same question from men, but it's whether it's an advantage or disadvantage, depend on the, I would say it's more to the women become the victim of it. So as you said, when you go forward, whether we can ask the same question, I don't think it will change, because men prefer, men has a choice. Men prefer women who supports their careers, and female also prefer men who support their careers. But it's very difficult. But I think after the new generation is coming up with that. So I'm shifting.
Hoping for change.
Hoping for change, because my son and daughter is completely different. They are still in teenage years. They are not looking at whether you are a man, whether you are a woman. They are looking at what we both can, I think, achieve together. So coming up, there, as you said, you never knew why you were coming to gender, but you were on your own making your own rights as a woman. So maybe that was in your subconscious for this shift. Now, women in work, what you work, is more mainly on corporate gender, right? So if you can just explain why it's more on corporate gender than the society gender and entrepreneur gender, if you can explain to
us. Sure. So the space that I'm in is gender equality is a pressing challenge for the private sector, not just the private sector, for Sri Lanka as a whole.
Yeah.
As you know, our female labor force participation has been stubbornly low for the past like decade. And we have been talking a lot about it, but nothing has really been done. So through the Women in Work program, there are multiple initiatives that we do. And the other important part is by bridging the gender gap in the country, we can increase our GDP by 20%.
Yes.
That's a lot, right? And what we're doing through the Women in Work program is there are multiple initiatives. And the initiative that I lead, which is the flagship program called as the She Work Sri Lanka Partnership, is a peer learning platform where we bring 15 leading companies in under one roof, and where we provide tools, techniques, so that they can go back and implement these gender smart solutions that are good for business, the employees, and for the economy as well. And we also consciously chose the sectors in a manner where we have a good representation of the leading sectors of Sri Lanka, and also male-dominated and female-dominated sectors as well. 2 years down the line, the results are fantastic. It's going to get released soon, but I'll just give you a glimpse of what's coming your way. So we have 9 out of 15 companies have increased the share of women representation across work levels. Childcare is no longer a barrier for women in the workforce, which is huge, right? And women are entering or shifting into male-dominated roles. And interestingly, women also moving towards leadership roles in female-dominated roles.
Yeah.
And female-dominated sectors, if I were to put it. And moving a bit
male-dominated.
So like for the garment sectors and etc. Yeah. So it's a female-dominated sector.
All right.
When you look at the leadership cadre, you don't find much.
Yes.
Exactly. So we have success stories where
so it's a blue-collar and white-collar employees. Okay.
Yeah, they are moving. And when you take a step back with the your supply chain cadre, your distributors, entrepreneurs and suppliers, when you have a gender balance amongst them, it directly has an impact in your company growth, productivity, etc. So these are the results that we have been able to achieve just in 2 years. So imagine if the rest of the private sectors and even the government, all of us really get together and pave the way forward for the rest of the private sectors. I mean, pave the way forward for the rest of the whole country to actually be able to bridge the gender gap. And we also started a campaign called Together We Can, which is to achieve this. And you will hear more from us by September, October. And yeah, that's something we're really looking forward to.
That's great. Most of the, I have seen that people has, misunderstood that gender is about discriminating men. Right, and it's not supporting men, it's about women. But I always say gender is men and women both. So in your work, how you have found that men supporting or female, because feminism is coming up with gender, right? And it's sometimes it's coming in a very negative way. How the work you're doing in corporate has supported on those men and women?
Sure. So what we focus on is the business case, right? So whether it's increased productivity, you build a diverse workforce, reduce absenteeism, etc. So for an organization to do that, you need both men and women, right? So, and also the focus goes back into building an equal and respectful workplaces for both men and women, where you're providing equal opportunities for both of them. where there are areas, like for example leadership or the certain areas when it comes to childcare, and even childcare, it's not just a woman's issue, it's a mother and father's issue. And we have some amazing stories of how fathers, the fact that they have a childcare facility.
So in your work, Women in Work, so you look at what the business case and how it can contribute to GDP. In your project, have you ever seen that women are making choices that even though the corporate is ready to give them a promotion or give them more responsibility, but they make their own choice and say, no, we are happy with our job, we are comfortable? Or have you seen men saying that, why it's for a woman, why can't I do it? Have you seen that? Because I'm asking you this question, most of the corporates, you get a lot of qualified women who are very comfortable with their position. They are not looking for a promotion or next step. So in your project, have you seen that kind of cases?
Very rare. Mm-hmm. And also, if there are such cases, it is completely their own personal choice, right?
Okay.
And but like through the She Works and the rest of the programs that we're doing, is where we're creating a family-friendly environment. So be it there are childcare policies, there are extended maternity leave, there's a career break. Say you want to follow your spouse somewhere.
So I'm just cutting you off. Extended maternity leave, is it positive for women to employment or it's a negative impact?
It's definitely a positive.
Corporate and, look at it as a positive or it's as an expense?
So this is where the business case comes
yeah,
in.
That's what
so
I wanted.
So it depends on your talent. Right? How much are you going to lose by, say, someone just leaves because of maternity leave? We
right.
have excellent business cases where the maternity leave has increased by 100%.
Right?
Right, and
okay.
especially, and people have also come back and moved into a promotion. So, and it's important that the line manager and the employee also has those honest, open conversations, and your performance is also quite clear. So those are the parts I feel that it makes a big difference.
Because I ask every time when the gender question comes, maternity leave, because of that we are losing women. So if there is a business case, if you have the results, I think it will be going to help a lot of women and also the corporates.
Sure.
So I'll shift again to your personal life, mm-hmm. coming from the gender and all that. How supportive your husband now with your, because I know you travel a lot because of COVID, you're in Colombo. How supportive and how, because you work late, you have projects, you travel. So how have you seen any, like being in a family like that, what is the positive side of that?
Oh, very supportive. And probably that's the reason I married him as well.
Yeah, okay.
And it's also like he, when I say supportive, yes, one angle is to support me in terms of career, and the other thing is we do a lot of our household responsibilities and everything together.
I know your husband cooks for you, right?
Don't make it sound like that. He doesn't cook for me, but my husband
cook for
does
us.
Cook.
Okay.
He,
because
I mean,
cook
he's
for
a great
us.
Cook.
Okay.
I mean, I can, but if I make a meal and if he makes a meal, you'll definitely eat what he makes. Right, but I'm the one who's like doing all the dishes and the rest of it, and we don't have any help. We do our household chores, everything we manage it on our own, and that is I feel that's really important when it comes to a partner, and how we really balance that makes a big difference.
Yeah, so I'm asking because you're newly married and you're young. So what is your message for young couples who, because I hear a lot of girls come say, I'm getting married next month, so I'm going to leave my job, right? And you were looking for a person to continue your job. And a lot of men think that women, when they come home, like their mother, the woman has to be at home, open the door, get them a tea. What is your message to young couples?
Sure. I would say, especially for women, okay, don't chase a wedding or the fact that you have to be married at a particular age.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, very important you find the right person.
When you say right person, what kind of?
Whatever, so you have to have common goals and
okay.
someone who can support. And I mean, I also have to equally play that role with my husband, right? He also has goals, aspiration, and I need to support him. So that's the balance.
Who can
that
support
you really
each
need.
Other?
Yeah. And it's not about what people think, what society wants. And that is number one. And number two is for women who want to pursue their career, be the absolute best version of yourself. You need to be world class in what you do. And you have to be so good that people can't ignore you across the table and look at you differently, but accept you for the great values that you bring onto the table.
Yeah. So, as Aarti said, it's not about getting married or having a wedding. It's about finding your soulmate. And it can be the right person or it can be the person whom you want to live with. And also, gender means not about women. It's about men and women working together. And I think you gave us a good insight about gender and young people and also the marriage and the culture. Thank you so much, Aarti, for joining. Is there any last message you want to give?
No, thank you for having me here. And it was fantastic.
I'm honored to have you.
Thank you.
Be tuned to Daily Mirror Online.